good editor must have some sense of how to tell a story, and that involves a sense of rhythm.
When an actor is freed up, they don't always do it exactly the same way, but if the eyes work and they're not basically in a totally wrong position, you can always make a cut. There's no such way as not being able to make a cut if you have a performance and you're watching the performance and you're involved, so that nobody's aware of your cutting.
And editing is why people like movies, because in the end, wouldn't we like to edit our own lives? I think we would. I think everybody would like to take out the bad parts, take out the slow parts, and look deeper into the good parts.
For a writer, it's a word, all right? For a composer or a musician, it's a note, all right? For an editor and a filmmaker, it's the frame.
We call it the invisible art, and indeed, it is. I mean, the more invisible we are, the better we're doing our job.
I think successful editors are really sly politicians.
Good evening. For around 120 years, cinema has shaped and changed the way we view the world, influencing the way that we interact with each other. And for every film made, there's been an editor there to help order the footage so it becomes palatable, manageable, and so the audience can understand. So what is the craft known as editing? Where did it begin? How has it developed cinema, and where will it take us next? I'm guerrilla filmmaker Cornelius Parchman, and in this documentary, we'll be delving into the complex world known as editing.
Commonly known as the invisible art, the role of an editor is to compile raw footage together with the aim to order it in such a way that the audience understands this production as a story. Scenes will typically go on much longer whilst on set than an audience will see, so the editor must cut down this time by jumping between shots and even skipping over time. But before the film industry got to this point, cinema as a form of entertainment was quite different. Back in England, in 1878, a photographer called Edward Muybridge set up a series of experiments to see whether or not a horse lifts up all four of his legs whilst galloping. A question that had stumped scientists for years, he placed a series of tripwires along a racetrack, each connected to a camera. As the horse ran over these wires, it would activate the camera's shutter release and take still images. Collectively, these photographs showed the movement of the animal. It revealed that at a certain point, horses do in fact lift all four legs off the ground. This was the first example of motion picture, and soon after, the cinematic world started to form. 1895. The Lumiere brothers premiere their invention, the cinemagraph, one of the first film projectors. Hosting a public screening of their productions, workers leaving a factory and arrival of a train in a small Paris cafe. This became a major event in film industry, for not only what the brothers had achieved, but how the audience reacted to the movies. Many viewers were frightened by the train rolling towards the camera, believing that it would come out of the screen and hit them. One of the people present in the audience for this premiere was a man named Georges Méliès, who would go on to produce hundreds of his own films and be considered one of the first editors and a pioneer of the industry. Méliès used simple editing techniques and special effects, such as jump cuts, to impress his audience, making the seamlessly impossible a reality. He'd also tint his film with different colours so that the characters or the scenery stood out from the rest of the shot. This was before Technicolor, so everything tinted was by hand. So to understand exactly why Méliès' films changed cinema, it's important to know the meaning behind specific editing techniques. Probably the most well-known of Méliès' filmography is the 1902 release, Trip to the Moon. This 10-minute production is about a group of scientists who built a rocket to fly to the moon, where they encounter a group of extraterrestrials. But as groundbreaking as these films were, Méliès set up each production as if they were performed on a stage in the theatre. cutting between single wide shots of the entire set so the audience could observe the action all at once. While the trip to the moon captivated its audiences for its visual editing and trickery, it was Edward S. Porter who introduced a narrative-based structure to editing. His 1903 release film, The Great Train Robbery, was arguably the first to feature many of the common editing techniques we see in modern cinema today. Porter would cut between parallel actions and build tension, moving back and forth between two locations held at the same shot. These highlighted an underlying connection between the audience to interpret. Other techniques first used in The Great Train Robbery include panning shots, location shooting, and multiple camera shots from one scene. The production was also filmed in a non-chronological order, then later edited to make a seamless cut, and famously used a close-up of one of the bandits at the end of his production. It features the robber staring at the camera and pointing his gun at the viewer, to which he then unloads a round of ammunition. This moment of breaking the fourth wall was not the first, but it did indeed shock the audience with the aggression of the action. This same shot was recreated in Martin Scorsese's Goodfellas, which happened to be edited by Thelma Shoemaker. Collaborating with Scorsese for more than 50 years, ever since his debut feature film, Who's That Knocking?, Shoemaker has contributed to some of the most iconic films of all time. Editing can be used to emphasize key moments in a scene. For example, slowing down the shot would draw the audience's attention to the action taking place. Shoemaker prioritizes the action of storytelling when it comes to her editing, wanting her audience to understand the narrative from beginning, middle, and end.
We like a certain roughness sometimes in the film editing style that maybe a Hollywood editor wouldn't like. Hollywood editors tend to like a slick style of editing where all the bumps are removed, but sometimes Marty and I like to keep in those bumps because they add a certain grittiness to the film, a certain reality. Or we like maybe to shock the audience with a cut they're not expecting, which will refresh them and make them look at something in a new way, instead of letting them glide through the film, which is the way some Hollywood editors like things to be. They don't want the audience to notice the editing. And he thinks like an editor when he conceives a film. He has a different editing style in mind for each film. He thinks like an editor when he's writing, co-writing it, when he's shooting it, and certainly then he comes into the editing room and directs the editing. We do it all together. And so I am blessed by having a director who actually is doing 50% of my work in the way he is conceiving it and laying it down on film, so that when we get in the editing room, it's got a conception, it's got a vision. I suppose that in America we have a very strong idea about narrative filmmaking, which is that we like a story. We like a story to be understandable from the beginning to the end. One of the things that amazed me when I went to Russia, I worked in Russia on a film, was that they didn't care at all about narrative structure. I mean, they didn't care if anything was explained in the plot. Other things interested them more. And that was quite revealing to me. And I think this is actually true in many cultures. It's also true in music. I know working with Peter Gabriel, he said that harmony is not such a major thing in other cultures. You know, it's only a minor thing for them. They're not interested in it. For us, harmony becomes a huge thing. But in all of the wonderful music that Peter Gabriel has brought to people's consciousness, that sort of thing is the least important thing, and that also was very revealing to me. So I think maybe the reason that American films appeal so much everywhere is because they tell a very good story. I think so, anyway. Maybe I'm wrong.
But before Shoemaker could edit a single one of Scorsese's films, cinema still had a lot to learn. The early 1900s were starting to move away from the stage-like imagery of the theatre. D.W. Griffin made a vast contribution to the editing industry, cutting between different types of shots to convey different levels of empathy, done to replicate how the human eye focuses on specific areas of its surroundings and blocks out everything else. One of Griffin's feature films, The Birth of a Nation, is considered by many as cinema's first ever blockbuster, raking in around $10 million at the box office. Nowadays, film historians recognize the impressive storytelling in this 3-hour production but can't ignore the film's racist overtones and portrayal of black Americans. Not forgetting how the Ku Klux Klan saves the townspeople and becomes the hero of the South. The development of editing didn't just come from Western cinema. By the year 1925, a new technique known as Russian montage editing emerged. Created in the USSR due to the lack of film stock available for filmmakers after the backlash of the 1917 Russian Revolution, it pushed filmmakers to produce movies by importing foreign films that paralleled the communist ideals of the country and spicing them with the limited amount of stock they had. These productions switched between its imagery but retained its underlying meaning. The Soviets also learned that cutting between shots would create a psychological connection between the two for the audience. So shot A, followed by shot B, then cutting back to shot A, seeps into the viewer's subconscious. This term is called the Khrushchev effect and was best seen in Sergei Eisenstein's battleship Potemkin. The editor believed that linking the foreign footage with the communist propaganda would have an emotional impact on the audience, making them sympathize with the Soviets' beliefs. Although America didn't share the Russians' communist values, they did align with the notion of women's role in the film industry, typically employing them as editors, believing that it wasn't much as an art form, more as a job. The 1930s saw most Hollywood productions produced hiring female editors who, despite being in control of how the final cut would look, had to follow a set of rules the studio laid out. These rules weren't officially given out, but over time, mainstream editors followed the same progression of shots. For example, they typically open a scene with a wide shot and slowly make their way to a close-up view of the characters.
Gentleman you meet among the cold cuts is simply not as attractive as one that you meet, say, in the mink department at Bergdorf's.
In the 40s and 50s, the audience would expect a character to drive up, show him getting out of the car, he would walk up to the building, and then he would open the door, and then the editor would match cut the door opening on the other side.
There wasn't much creative freedom, as these editors had to present the film in such a way that it was accessible for contemporary audiences.
Passport, please.
Oh.
What's the purpose of your visit here?
A friend of mine offered me a job here.
Where are you staying?
With him, 15 Stiftgasse.
His name?
Lime, Harry Lime.
Okay.
Thought he'd be here to meet me.
If we were to think about the films that were being made, there was a certain film language that was very, very distinct. Certain kinds of coverage, long shot, two shot, single. There was almost a formulaic way of presenting films. This film language was very strict, and in editorial terms, there were rules that one felt could not be broken.
The fundamentals of film editing had already been established at this point, so to progress the medium further, it required creatives to break these rules, to find new ways to use them. Orson Welles' Citizen Kane utilized techniques the forefathers of film set out, but demonstrated these in more remarkable ways. Overlapping dialogue between characters and complex montages linked by the related sound effects or music. Most noticeably, in the opening scene, where the newsreel tells the audience about the life of Charles Foster Kane. The film is also structured in a non-linear narrative, which means each scene moves back and forth between the events of Kane's life. Welles opens the film with the death of Kane in his old age, then abruptly cuts to News on the March, leaving a significant impact as the audience are shocked and confused. This caused this type of response, since before the release of Citizen Kane, the classic Hollywood narrative structure introduces a character, creates a problem, forces them to develop themselves, and then resolves the issue. But here the film begins with the end. We don't know anything about the character, so we can't feel any sympathy for his death until later on in the film.
Monta, monta! Vai a pezzo, corri! Corri, dai! Corri! Avverti il turno, l'ho detto io! Corri!
It was films like Citizen Kane, which challenged the form of storytelling, that inspired subgenres to emerge during the 1950s and 60s. Italian neorealism, French New Wave, and American New Wave. These subgenres rebelled against the conservative way of filmmaking that dominated the industry out of frustration of artistic differences. So here we start to see films being made that completely ignore the methods used in the classic age of Hollywood. The 1959 Breathless stands out as a key turning point for editing as a craft. The French-made production expresses its desire to be experimental through its editing. It uses jump cuts to change location dramatically, and even breaking continuity. This unorthodox way of filmmaking proved to be refreshing for the audience, as it showed that films didn't have to follow the same rigid format, and instead show what they could become. Even in America, you had films such as Easy Rider, where the editing became quite playful, using jump cuts as the transitions to switch back and forth between the two scenes. In a quick time flash cut from shot to shot, the audience is being told that the film is progressing to a new part of the narrative.
So I had only had one feature under my belt. We started on Easy Rider. I was editing while they were traveling. Footage was flowing in by the mile. It was great, it was exciting, it was totally different than anything I had been involved in.
You asshole!
These transitions that everybody remembers going from one scene to the next, where it flashes forward to the scene, flashes back to the scene you're in. Dennis didn't want a straight cut. I didn't want dissolves. So we kept throwing it around, and it was Dennis who cooked the part of the idea, which was, what if we went and then came back? And I said, yeah, but let's do it three times. Then we finally arrived at the length. And each one is 6 frames. I said, now we can use this whenever we want to. Well, as it turned out, it started to become a device. And we sort of stopped doing that. I said, no, we aren't going to do that. We only use it in special places. Without giving anything away, everybody was stoned when they were shooting. I learned soon on that I could not be stoned and edit. While it was going on, I thought it was grand. Then I look at it when I was straight and I say, this is awful. I got to throw it out and start all over. This film has become an icon. I'm grateful that I had something to do with it, because I had grown up in the 30s, 40s, and 50s with movies as they were then. And finally, we're going to run it for Columbia with Leo Jaffe, chairman of the board. It ended. There was this long pause. Leo finally stands up, and then he says, I don't know what the fuck this picture means, but I know we're going to make a fuck of a lot of money.
Although it doesn't make it seamless, it does remind the viewer that there is a story being told that's different to real life. Now we're seeing the entertainment industry starting to venture out to new territories. But what about other mediums such as music videos and documentaries? How does editing play a role in crafting these kind of productions? And how do they differ from film editing? The purpose of a music video is to show a visual representation of the song's meaning. In other words, music videos were created so the artists could express themselves through a multimedia format, building a deeper connection with fans, which ultimately helped them to sell more records. The three types of music videos are performance-based, narrative-based, and abstract. The most common basic form of editing is the jump cut. Even in a narrative-based music video, they will use this technique to progress the narrative further. This type of editing also allows for more contextual imagery to be used. It's also because for a lot of artists, they only have 3 to 4 minutes runtime for their music videos. So they try and fit as much in as possible, including many different shots or locations, depending on the genre. It should be the duty of an editor to immerse the audience in the storytelling experience. This doesn't always require the special effects or dramatic transitions. Documentary filmmaking requires a different kind of editing mindset. Unlike music videos or film, you have to show your audience the specific details of your chosen topic whilst maintaining a level of interest, to educate, but also entertain. So a good way to do this is by utilizing the editing mode and creating a production that's visually stimulating as well as informative. For the four types of documentaries, performance-based, observational, interactive, and reflective, you structure and style your production accordingly. Looking at the modern film industry, it seems that mainstream Hollywood has lost interest in creative editing. Many films coming out nowadays fall into the same sequence of cuts, as if we're going back to the time of classical Hollywood. But it's people like Walter Falsano that are keeping the craft alive and engaging. Working as lead editor for Luca Guadagnino's summer romance, Call Me By Your Name, one of the most captivating gay love films in the genre. The 2017 release tells the story of a 17-year-old teenager who develops a relationship for his father's summer school student. The entire film was shot on a 35mm lens to resemble the human eye, which meant that the audience would be immersed by the cinematic experience. Falsano has collaborated with Luca for more than 25 years. He talks about how he's developed a clear understanding of what the director wants out of a film.
I think he deals with what happens in life, in life's first love. And I think that all the turmoil and in a life-changing experience, in a coming-of-age tale, as they call it, I think everybody can mirror into that. I don't think it's necessarily tied to an homosexual relationship, but it's more universal.
He thinks that the audience should have an active role in the experience and not simply sit back passively, letting everything be explained to them. Which is why Call Me By Your Name is unorthodox in its editing style, since Falsano was inspired by the creative freedom of the French New Wave films, where cuts and transitions were made when necessary to drive the narrative forward, but also to hold on to shots so the audience has the chance to pick apart the characters' performances. Call Me By Your Name was shot in continuity, which made it possible for the film and its actors to develop their crafts in real time. Falsano, like any other editor, uses basic editing techniques in his work to highlight key moments, as well as draw in the audience's attention. And although I can't talk about every technique used in every film ever, here are just a few to improve the quality of your production. Holding long. This kind of shot makes the audience take control of the film, pushing them to actively engage in the experience. If you hold on to a shot long enough without cutting away, the human subconscious will automatically start to search for meaning. Something that once had the equivalent of importance to the previous shot now has the audience's complete attention, questioning its existence. With enough on-screen time, the viewer will fill in the blanks, which is a great device to use for building tension, as seen in 2013's Ida. We hold onto the shot of a window long enough for our minds to contemplate its significance, which ultimately leads to the character committing suicide. Cutting short. Think of this as the opposite to holding long. The technique is most commonly known as the smash cut, where a scene ends abruptly just as it begins. Cutting short is used to convey the meaningless of the scene, combined with the expectation that something's going to happen, only to realize that nothing does. A different use of the technique is referred to as the smash ending, in which the scene ends before the viewer is told all the necessary information. Probably the most famous example of this is the end of Inception, as it's meant to imply that not knowing the character's fate is the point of the film. The audience is left confused as they're not being shown the full frame. The importance of the transition is greater than most give it credit. It's the flow of any production, how you move from scene to scene. Typically, most films will include the simple cut to progress the narrative further. However, these basic transitions of cinema can
can be more creative. Such techniques include swipes, dissolves, and fading into black. But sticking to these traditional cuts doesn't make your production any less interesting. It's how you use them. It's down to the reasoning behind how you cut between shots, considering what's in the frame and how it relates to the next shot or scene. If we look back at how editing has impacted cinema, we'll see that it not only provides the rhythm of the production, but it allows the filmmaker to choose how they want to tell their story. It can be the difference between a multi-million blockbuster picture and a straight-to-DVD catastrophe. You can have the best director, high-profile actors, and a huge budget, but if your production's editing has a negative impact on the narrative, then your audience will pick up on this quickly, and your film will perform poorly. In today's mainstream cinema, we're seeing the role of the editor being neglected, and in turn contribute to the demise of some of the most anticipated recent films. So if anything's to be obtained from this, it's that filmmakers need to consider all aspects of their movies, both pre- and post-production, because any film is only as good as its weakest attribute. I've been Cornelius Parchman, and this has been The Importance of Editing, or How I Stopped Complaining and Learned to Love Premiere Pro.